Last time on the Vintage Collector, it once dominated the market of microcomputers, CPM. But after the mishaps around the IBM PC and losing out to Microsoft's CPM clone MS-DOS, DRI went through troubled times. All hopes were on DRDOS to save the day. This is September, the month to honor CPM, the ancestor to DOS. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories.
Ah, du schaffst ja mit MS-DOS. Nimm doch DR-OpenDOS, das ist besser.
Was, DR-OpenDOS? Hat doch Norton Utilities. I remember my dad's friend, who was also into IT, somewhere in the early 90s, telling me about DR-OpenDOS and me wrongly understanding it as something like the Norton Utilities.
But when I came out of my house, I could see there was an accident and the car had crashed into a bus.
Now, little fun fact here about Swiss people. We tend to speak Helvetic English. There's that nice video over here giving a really good impression of what I mean by that. That said, all English words are usually dialectized, and apparently many people didn't get DDR as being short for digital research, but being the short form for doctor, hence DR-OpenDOS, or in Swiss German, eben DR-OpenDOS. Anyways, when DR-OpenDOS came along, it was essentially CPM86 that lost the capability to run CPM programs, but instead had gained MS-DOS compatibility. Its direct predecessor, DOS Plus, could still run CPM programs, but this was now from days past. DR-OpenDOS is said to have claimed some market share between 5-10%, depending on the source. For certain is that it definitely gained some following in the German area of Europe. The reason behind was Vobis and his CEO Theo Lieven. He was known for not always coming to easy terms with Microsoft's dictate. So there was always periods where Vobis would bundle their machines either with PC-DOS, OS2, or in the years before with DR-DOS. This is pure speculation, but because of being suddenly in the role of the underdog in a market they once dominated, and a maybe not so straightforward product development roadmap, as we had just seen, digital research for sure had one thing: gifted and talented people, leading into further interesting products like FlexOS, a real-time operating system, and also GEM, the graphical environment manager that was adapted as the default GUI for the Atari ST. Meanwhile, DR-DOS development took off by a DRI offshoot in Britain. So indeed, DR-DOS was developed in Europe. And they did quite good and innovative progress, typically staying ahead of the competing MS-DOS release by 1 year, like supporting hard drives over 32 megabytes way ahead of time. And Microsoft naturally taking every opportunity to backlash, like bringing down disk compression with negative arguments at one stage when DR-DOS had it, and then including the same technology themselves some 2 years after. Novell back then was the big player in the network market and widely known for their NetWare network operating system, but also introducing de facto standards like the NE2000 network card that spun off an entire market of compatible clones. Going along with the DRI acquisition during that time, Novell also bought the Unix System Laboratories, the Were Perfect Corporation and Quattro Pro from Borland, following a strategy to put Novell into better competition against Microsoft. Having DRDOS in Novell's portfolio soon after saw some effect, as DRDOS 6 saw the inclusion of NetWare Lite. Ultimately, DRDOS 7 was launched as NovellDOS 7 in 1994 and included an improved version called Personal NetWare. It was also during the early 90s period when Microsoft actively intrigued consumers by including spurious errors in the beta version for Windows 3.1, known as the AARD code. These pseudo-error messages were done in a way to spread discomfort and motivate consumers to go out buying the compatible MS-DOS instead. Although Novell's DRDOS group was quick enough to bring a fix to circumvent these non-errors, damage was already done. Ultimately, Novell's plans for spearheading against Microsoft didn't play out, and after only 5 years, DRDOS went on to Caldera in 1996. The latter then fired off a lawsuit against Microsoft for destroying DRDOS's reputation, namely the AARD code in particular, but also by binding Windows 95 onto MS-DOS 7 and locking competitors out, to which Caldera proved that Windows 95 could be made to run on DRDOS. As a result of a settlement agreement, Microsoft eventually paid a compensation of $280 million to Caldera. Caldera continued to release new versions of DRDOS, then named OpenDOS 7 and later DR-OpenDOS 7 and ultimately DRDOS, this time round with a hyphen added in the name. Although these versions didn't significantly advance over Novell's DOS 7 and were in some areas even beyond the latest contributions and patches by Novell. DRDOS ultimately was moved from Caldera UK Limited to the Caldera Thin Client subsidiary, which was then spun off into an independent company named Lineo, from which it was passed on to DeviceLogics DRDOS Incorporated. DeviceLogics released two more versions, DRDOS 8 and DRDOS 8.1, of which especially the latter caused controversy from unauthorized use of GPL code by including tools from FreeDOS. Both versions were eventually withdrawn. This makes DRDOS 7.03 from 1999 the last official release ever seen of DRDOS. There was, however, Udo Kuhnt, who continued to provide patches for DRDOS under the name of Enhanced DRDOS. These were based on the release source code of ibmbio.com, ibmdos.com and command.com that were originally included with the OpenDOS 7.01 release. These unofficial enhancements to DRDOS ended with the last incompleted release, 7.0108, in 2011. By that time, CPM's inventor Gary Kildall was unfortunately no longer with us. He died from the effects of a serious head injury on July 8, 1994, at the age of 52. Being a creative head for many years, Kildall pioneered many inventions and some of his contributions are still around to this day. There's some sources describing him as an adventurous and easygoing person, but an engineer at heart. Between 1983 and 1990, Gary was also co-host alongside Stuart Chaffee for the Computer Chronicles, a program that ran between 1983 and 2002, which explored the technological evolution in the IT and computing industry. According to various sources, Kildall expressed his grief in later years about being continuously left behind Microsoft, coming to receive late recognition only after his early death.
When we first launched this series, sitting by my side as co-host was Gary Kildall. But Gary was a lot more than a TV host. Gary, in fact, was one of the most important individuals in the history of personal computing.
And if you want to learn more, then I can only recommend you to go watching the tribute done to him by Stuart Chaffee in the Computer Chronicles. For me, it remains to say, Kildall's legacy should never be forgotten. And if there's someone from the League of Influential Persons in the IT industry I could choose from for a direct conversation, Gary Kildall would definitely be a go-to person for me.